Fox News podcast presents Bret Baier's All-Star Panel.
America's got to be in the lead if you want to deal with these threats. We're going to lead.
The morning is over. The Shiva is done. And if you're a conservative, you should be optimistic.
You know, my main priority right now is making sure that it delivers for the American people.
We have to make our country great again, and I will do that.
I think the president gets criticized by people all the time for the stuff he says, by people who ignore what he does.
Now, Fox's chief political anchor, Bret Baier.
As President Biden is overseas with other world leaders at his last G20 summit, Russian President Vladimir Putin is slamming the Biden administration for being, in his words, reckless after authorizing the Ukrainian use of American missiles, the first long-range attack inside Russia, amidst President Biden's climate change remarks.
History is watching us. History is watching. I urge us to keep faith and keep going. This is the single greatest existential threat to humanity if we do not deal with climate change.
Meanwhile, President-elect Trump's cabinet continues to take shape, at least the nominees, as he nominates members to stand by his side. Many Americans are looking at Tom Holman, President-elect Trump's pick for border czar, to see how he may address America's immigration policies. To discuss this and more, we bring in our panel, founding editor at the Washington Free Beacon, Matthew Continetti, Democratic strategist Leslie Marshall, and Fox News senior congressional correspondent Chad Pergram. Chad, up on the Hill, there's a lot of angst about how these nominees are going to be received and what the process will be. What's the scuttlebutt now with, I guess, the biggest target for Democrats and those skeptical is Matt Gaetz?
Yeah, a lot of Republicans, frankly, are very skeptical about Matt Gaetz. They're not quite sure that he can get through the Senate. A lot of them have their own reservations. We're watching to see what the House Ethics Committee might do on Wednesday. They meet. They have this report about his alleged misconduct. They were investigating, and this is according to the committee. Alleged sexual misconduct and potential illicit drug use, whether or not that report ever sees the light of day or maybe is forced out on the floor or maybe is subpoenaed by the Senate Judiciary Committee, which reviews and has the confirmation process for Matt Gaetz for Attorney General, remains to be seen. Now, J.D. Vance, he is on Capitol Hill today. He's going to be on Capitol Hill tomorrow. He is facilitating meetings between Gaetz and some members of the Judiciary Committee, Mike Lee, Republican of Utah, also John Kennedy, the Republican from Louisiana. Whether or not that makes a difference, I don't know. You know, there were some people who don't have a vote on this, but are Republicans. Don Bacon, the Republican Nebraska representative who represents a swing district and won re-election, who said we can basically do better than that. And that's something that Hakeem Jeffries, the Democratic leader in the House of Representatives, said as well. So, again, that's going to be very tough. And this is really the first big test of John Thune. It might not just be Matt Gaetz, but what if some of these other nominees go sideways? At some point, does President-elect Trump turn on Thune or Senate Republicans and say, you guys aren't getting my nominees through? What's wrong with you? Remember that he had a lot of problems, President-elect Trump did, with the outgoing Senate Minority Leader Mitch McConnell. And while John Thune has tried to work on this relationship with the incoming president, this is not exactly a great hand to play.
Leslie, is it possible that if one nominee goes down, that Democrats and those that are, trying to be skeptical and vote against someone will be happy with that and let others go? I mean, is it possible that there is a steamroller that allows the others to go through with one scalp taken?
Look, from talking to those in my party, the Democrats, there are people out there that don't make my side skin crawl, people, Doug Collins, people, we politically disagree, but Doug and I, former Congressman Collins, are friends. We may not agree, politically. And this is a man, who is a veteran and, people say him running the VA. And it doesn't even come down to experience when you have, to Chad's point, alleged sexual misconduct and, more specifically, alleged sexual misconduct with a minor. And especially when, so many Republicans are evangelical Christians or, claim to be the party of family values, the list goes on. But to your point, You know, it's going to be on an individual basis because there are some extreme elements of this agenda and extreme elements with some of these individuals. Like, you know, there's a lot of concern about, you know, what would RFK Jr. do? There's a lot of concern about what Tom Holman's going to do. And certainly when it comes to, let's just look at immigration, Bret, you know, Matt Gaetz, if he were confirmed as attorney general, you know, he can apply certain rulings to immigration courts within his power as attorney general. Let's look at Kristi Noem. A lot of people say, you know, her state has the smallest amount of undocumented workers in the country. She just doesn't have the experience for that. So I really think it's going to be taken on a case-by-case basis because there are people out there who do not support the more radical ideals of some of these nominees. But for others who are experienced, I don't think the Democrats, at least what they're telling me, and even my own opinion, I'll have as much of a problem or discomfort with that, with these individuals in those positions.
Yeah, Matthew, I guess the sentiment is the people voted. The president-elect now received 312 electoral votes to 226. He's going to win the popular vote. It'll be, you know, 1 to 2 points when all is said and done, but he's going to win the popular vote. So there is leeway there, and he clearly campaigned on shaking up the system. So in his mind, he's choosing people that are shaking up the system. How much, you know, leeway does he get there because of what the electorate decided?
I think the electorate's desire for change and the vote it gave for Trump and the Republicans gives the president a lot of leeway, Bret. I mean, let's not forget, this wasn't just Donald Trump winning a second term in this incredible comeback. It was also Republicans winning the House. It was Republicans winning the Senate, 53 seats for the Republicans in the Senate. That gives Trump some wiggle room. The Democrats don't really matter here in terms of the confirmation. Now, it's interesting because there were quite a few Republicans who voted for Joe Biden's nominees, but we're not even expecting Democrats to vote for Trump's more controversial nominees. It really comes down to, can the more controversial nominees, Gaetz, Gabbard, Hegseth, RFK Jr., just announced before we recorded, Dr. Oz, Mehmet Oz for the Center for Medicare and Medicaid Services, are they going to be able to win over enough Republicans? And I think it's a case-by-case basis, as was said here. But I also think many of the concerns of some of the Republican senators expressed behind the scenes are not about the agenda. It's not about what Trump wants to do or what Trump expects his appointees to do. It's more about qualifications and capabilities. And it's going to come down to how much political capital is President-elect Trump willing to spend on some of these nominees. Right now with Matt Gaetz, it seems like he is willing to spend some political capital to make sure someone like Gaetz, who is a rebel like Trump, who is a very good communicator like Trump, and who is very loyal to Trump, gets that job.
Mm-hmm. Chad mentioned immigration and Tom Holman, the president-elect's pick for border czar. He's already talking about what it's going to look like trying to get deportation efforts up and starting to go after criminals and terrorists and gangs first. But there's a lot of concern about what that eventually looks like, especially with some Democratic mayors and governors saying they're going to hold the line and kind of push back against this. This sets up a real question on Capitol Hill.
You could certainly have a clash between those mayors and state governors. Also, you know, the use of the military, that's going to be something that I think certain defense hawks on the Republican side of the aisle are going to be wary about, depending on how that plays out and what they think is, you know, questions of lawful orders. If it gets to that, that's something that people are watching very closely. The other thing that I would talk about here that very few people have addressed is, what is the cost? We've seen some different figures here, yes, but there has to be an appropriation for this. And when you talk about all this, you know, cutting of spending and everything else, and this is something that Elon Musk and others are involved in, and Vivek Ramaswamy, what is going to be the appropriation for the Department of Homeland Security? or the Pentagon that is devoted to that, and therefore are you draining resources from somewhere else? Does that come out formally in the president's budget request that'll be, you know, due in the first quarter of the year? Is it going to be appropriated into the bills there? Will people support that? Because, you know, this is the ultimate power of the Congress, the purse strings, and they can either engage with those initiatives by the president, or they can cut them off. And if maybe, you know, there's the appetite on Capitol Hill that, you know, they've gone too far, they might not give the president the power to go as far as he wants because of the purse strings. And remember, it comes down to the numbers in the House of Representatives. We're going to have a very similar number as we had this past Congress. You're really going to be able to only lose about two, maybe three votes per roll call vote on the floor. And, you know, that didn't work out too hot for the Republicans over the past couple of years. It probably helps, you know, with the president flying air cover for them in the House of Representatives because it's his initiative and many of them campaigned on that and they want to support the president. But if it goes too far, you know, because you're going to have to cut someplace else. And then that's why the equation gets very, very complicated and it makes it very challenging to actually approve that bill.
Panel, we'll hold it right there. Leslie, is your party in the wilderness now? What's happening?
No, we're not in the wilderness. You know, when you speak to an issue like immigration and when you just look at numbers, most people didn't vote for Donald Trump because of mass deportation. Actually, poll after poll shows the majority of Americans don't want mass deportation. And the people that they want deported are people who are criminals. The majority of people in this country of the undocumented population are here because they have expired work visas or student visas. And then after that, you know, people forget about grandma and grandpa. I mean, there are people that have been in this country undocumented longer than I've been alive. And I was born here. And I don't think Americans honestly know what that looks like. And then you have errors, Bret. I mean, you have children that are American citizens. And, you know, we've even, you know, heard, you know, Tom Holman talk about self-deportation or, you know, we'll have them go with their parents. Well, it's a really sticky area because, you know, the child has the choice to stay here. They are a United States citizen. And when we look at the last time America, the United States of America, deported Mexicans en masse, which we have shamefully in our history, we deported a large percentage of American citizens. Let's look at the money if people don't care about human beings. Let's look at the money. You're talking about this will cut 6.8% of our national gross domestic product. This will kill construction and agricultural business. And then to Chad's point, how much is this going to cost? There are numbers upwards of $80 billion and higher. And then time, the logistics of deporting 11 plus million people, you're talking about 10 years. So this is not realistic, but there are a lot of people that are fearful. I know people here in California that voted for Donald Trump because they felt that their grandmother wouldn't be deported because, you know, they're not criminals. They're law-abiding citizens. They've been here a long time. So I don't think that everybody who voted for him thought he would really do this or what it really meant.
And we don't know what it looks like yet, Matthew. I mean, to be honest with us, you hear Tom Holman talk about it, but it's not crystallized as of yet. And I don't think it's going to go 0-60 on day one.
Probably not. Tom Holman, who will be in the White House as the border czar, has given us some clues as to how he's approaching the issue and how President Trump is approaching the issue, beginning with securing the southern border, which was a vote-driving issue in this election, then moving to removing the criminals on the streets and to potential national security or terror threats. And then Tom Holman, interestingly, talk about human beings. Leslie, Tom Holman has been saying there are hundreds of thousands of children who are missing, who have slipped through the system. And so it's incumbent, I think, to find them, because I'm sure that many of them are being exploited. And I do just want to introduce a few numbers into this debate. According to the Fox News voter analysis, immigration was the number two vote driving issue in the election. About a fifth of the electorate said it was the most important issue in the country. And Donald Trump won those voters by 79 points. So I think voters chose Trump with clear eyes about what he was talking about in terms of immigration and what was necessary to correct the errors of Joe Biden's immigration policy. I'll also note that in a June Gallup poll, 47% of Americans said they favored, and I quote, deporting all immigrants who are living in the United States illegally back to their home country. And in an October poll from Marquette Law School, 58% of registered voters backed deporting immigrants who are living in the United States illegally back to their home countries. There is public support for the policy that Donald Trump has laid out and that Tom Homan is formulating as they prepare to take office in January. So yes, there will be costs. There will certainly be resistance from the Democrats, from the judiciary, maybe some of the governors in the states, the blue states for sure. But I think we shouldn't ignore the fact that this was a major issue in the election, an election that Donald Trump and the Republicans won.
But you know what? So can I just jump in, Bret? So was the price of food, right? And when you rip apart the agricultural sector, which my state has the majority of agriculture that the rest of the country relies on, you know, when if you're paying $8 for a bag of lettuce and $10 for an avocado.
I think it's really interesting, Leslie, that you're concerned about inflation now, 4 years after the Biden inflation and the Biden administration said that inflation was taken care of. Look, I just laid out the priorities here. Going after the businesses that are employing illegal labor is certainly on the top of mind of many people who favor a more restrictive immigration policy, but I don't think it's the top priority for this incoming administration. I do think the top priorities remain securing the border and then finding the security threats and criminals who have come into our country over the past 4 years.
Yeah. And you're right, Leslie. We don't know, you know, if it continues past that, if it goes on. I just don't see them kicking in doors to get Abuelita, the grandma. I mean, I just don't see it. But maybe I'm wrong.
I hope that you're right and I'm wrong, but I do see it because there's just like a shine in Tom Holman's eyes, you know, and some of the words, some of the phrasing that I'm hearing coming out of him and other Republicans with regard to mass deportation. It scares me. How many Republicans have said, hey, wait a minute, does this mean I lose my gardener or my nanny? You know, I mean, like I said, I don't think a lot of people knew what they were voting for specifically with this mass deportation generalized title.
Well, we're going to continue to ask questions about it and get more details as we get closer to inauguration. Last word, Chad, there will be a lot of things that happen fast and furious after January 20th. One of them is about the economy and how they'll deal with economic issues. They will, since they'll have the House and the Senate, have reconciliation, which enables anything under the budget to go through the House and then go to the Senate with 50 votes. So they can pack a lot in there. Democrats did.
Potentially. It just depends on the votes, as you say. You know, I talked to somebody the other day about, you know, would they just do a shell budget, you know, just so they had the reconciliation package available. You have to have a budget of some form, even if it just has a couple of commas in it, or an actual budget in order to have reconciliation be available as a parliamentary option. And they said, no, we're going to do a real budget. And, Bret, I cannot tell you how many times that I have seen, especially on the Republican side of the aisle, but certainly on the Democratic side, too, where they have promised, you know, and talked about the importance of budgeting and sticking to the budget process. And they have not had the votes again to pass a budget. So, again, that's the skepticism that is coming out from Capitol Hill. You know, there is going to be some of this unanimity, you know, in the afterglow of the election. I think that that's certainly going to buoy some Republicans in both the House and Senate. But again, you know, when it gets down to the details, that gets very challenging. And that's why a lot of times those budgets are not adopted.
All right, panel, thanks so much. Now for a bit of history. November 22nd, 1963. The day America mourned the loss of its youngest president, John F. Kennedy. The president was assassinated in Texas during a motorcade with his wife, causing devastation to sweep the country as the reality set in. After the tragedy, President Lyndon B. Johnson was sworn in on Air Force One at Dallas Love Field Airport. 7 minutes later, that airplane left for Washington, D.C. President Johnson's first proclamation declared November 25th a national day of mourning for the 35th president. That'll do it for this week. You can hear more of this series at foxnewspodcast.com or wherever you download podcasts. Make sure to leave a rating and a review. We want to hear from you. For Leslie, Chad, and Matt, I'm Bret Baier. We'll see you next time. Listen ad-free with a Fox News Podcast Plus subscription on Apple Podcasts, and Amazon Prime members can listen to this show ad-free on the Amazon Music app.